It has stood the test of time. God's book, the Bible. Still relevant in today's complex world. It is written. Sharing hope around the globe.
And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was the governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city.
I'm John Bradshaw. Thanks for joining me today. It's that time of year. The Christmas music has been playing in stores for weeks. Christmas meals have been planned down to the last mince pie. The trees are up, real ones and artificial ones. Family gatherings have been anticipated for ages, and people have traveled often many miles to be with relatives. The kids are going to get to see Grandma and Grandpa again. Retailers are either breathing easy or licking their wounds. Christmas lights are twinkling. Carolers have gone out spreading Christmas joy. Work parties have been attended, bonus checks have been gratefully received, Christmas cards have been sent and received from long-ago friends and distant relatives. Catalogs from companies you didn't even know existed have arrived in your mailbox. People are planning to enjoy one last splurge before starting their diet in the new year. Cantatas have been enjoyed, the Hallelujah chorus has moved hearts. Nativity scenes grace front yards. Some people are enjoying a white Christmas. And where I grew up, people are heading to the beach and trying to avoid sunburn. Christmas. Andy Williams sang that it's the most wonderful time of the year. It's hard to argue with that. At Christmas time, people tend to be happy. Life slows down for a day or two, long enough for people to connect with loved ones and friends. And in this culture of ours, a major Christmas tradition is gift-giving. In fact, you could say that maybe it's the overriding Christmas tradition. We know that Christmas is a religious tradition, a biblical tradition. It's a Christian tradition. Yet even atheists participate in celebrating Christmas and in giving and receiving gifts. In fact, if you went to any shopping center at all, you'd get the impression that Christmas is all about the gifts. Every Christmas season, all across the fruited plain, children sit on Santa's knee and tell him that they want bicycles and Lego sets and scooters and dolls and video games and a whole lot more beside. Adults will be wanting clothes and golf clubs and iPods and camera gear and video games and a whole lot more beside. What do you want for Christmas? Some years ago, I asked several people to tell me about the best gift they'd ever received. Now, their response didn't really surprise me. I know for a fact that some of them had over the years been given some pretty impressive and expensive gifts. But not one of them told me that the best gift they'd ever received was a new car or a vacation in Hawaii or a new flat-screen television set. Each of them told me a similar story. It was in every case something like, I remember years ago, it was my birthday, and my daughter, she was just little then, she went and made me a beautiful card and she decorated it and she wrote the sweetest things on there. And you know, I've still got that card. Nothing I've ever been given means as much to me as that card does. It wasn't the diamond ring, it wasn't the fur coat, it wasn't a Rolex, but something from the heart, something simple, something pure, something that represents true, genuine love. Doesn't that sound like Christmas? Really, when you stop and think about it, overeating, overspending, and overindulging don't have a whole lot to do with the birth of Jesus. So what really matters most at Christmas time? How would you end the sentence if you were to say, all I want for Christmas is? What would make Christmas truly special for you? What's the essence of the Christmas story? I'm sure you might be able to answer that question in any number of ways, but there's a Bible verse that, for me, brings us back to the very heart of it all. John 3, verse 16 says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The reason Christmas is observed at all is that long ago the decision was made that Jesus would be given to the human family. God gave, and He gave the greatest and most expensive gift that could possibly be given. Remember how the prophet Isaiah put it in chapter 9 and verse 6.
"For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon His shoulder."
Notice, unto us a son is given. Beyond the Christmas lights on the houses, beyond the Christmas trees, beyond the mountains and mountains of wrapping paper, beyond the last-minute Christmas shopping on Christmas Eve, men, you know what I mean, beyond everything, Christmas as a Christian tradition stems from the fact that God sent Jesus into the world. And what did He do that for? As John 3 and verse 17 says, "For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved." God was so committed to giving you and me every opportunity to experience character transformation. He was so committed to you and me being forgiven and cleansed and freed from guilt. God was so committed to us having everlasting life that He gave the greatest gift given ever by anyone to anyone ever. He gave Jesus. He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You know, there have been some pretty remarkable gifts given over the years. Russian business tycoon Roman Abramovich bought his girlfriend a $14 million sculpture. English soccer player David Beckham is said to have spent £80,000 on a bag for his wife. An American movie star evidently bought a 200-year-old olive tree for her movie star husband for $18,000 for a tree. A musician bought his son a car for his 16th birthday. A $360,000 car. Too bad the boy didn't have his driver's license yet. An Indian businessman bought his wife a $60 million luxury jet for her 44th birthday. His brother obviously felt the heat, and so he bought his wife a luxury yacht shortly afterwards, worth more than $80 million. Of course, there's India's Taj Mahal. That was a gift given by an Indian emperor to his deceased wife. Impressive gifts. But are they the gifts that really matter most? In a moment, what really does matter most at Christmas?
"And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn."
And here's today's Bible question. Was Jesus a created being, an angel? The Bible comments on this directly in several places. Hebrews 1 verse 4 says that Jesus was made so much better than the angels. So He's not an angel. So then, was He made? The Bible says He was made. Well, that word made doesn't always mean made as in brought into existence. Many Bible translations say that in a different way. And then Hebrews 1 verse 5, the very next verse, says that Jesus is God's Son. Jesus wasn't an angel and he wasn't created. Now come back with me right back to the beginning. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Now notice verse 26, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." Our? That's plural. And that's because the Father, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus were present at creation. It'd be hard to believe Jesus was a created being and the Creator. John 1 verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Now that's Jesus we're talking about. And then verse 3 says, "All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made." So Jesus was the Creator, not the created. He wasn't made. He wasn't brought into existence. He wasn't originated. Jesus is eternal. There's a reason it's hard for us humans to get our minds around that, because we're human. Everything from our perspective has a beginning in our minds. Well, as the Bible says, God's ways aren't our ways and God's thoughts aren't our thoughts. And I'm glad that God doesn't have to operate under the same constraints as people do. That would make God a pretty small God. If you have a question you'd like answered, go to itiswritten.com, click on the Questions tab and submit your question. I hope I'll be able to answer your Bible question.
If you have a Bible question for Pastor John Bradshaw, please write to It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91359, or visit our website, itiswritten.com, and send us your questions online.
Said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of a heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men."
Thanks for joining me today. Even though Jesus was not born on December the 25th, it's become the day on which the Christian world remembers that great event when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, when the Messiah came into the world to be its Savior. Christmas in the Western world is characterized by family gatherings, house decorating, food consuming, gift giving. And sometimes it seems as though we might just miss the point. As you look around, would you really get the impression that Christmas is actually about Jesus? Or does it look like it's more about sales and stuff and possessions? I remember one Christmas seeing a young boy who'd forgotten all about the gifts that he was given, but he was having the time of his life playing with the wrapping that the gifts had come in. He was having more fun with a plastic bag than he ever did with the expensive toys that he'd been given. I hope yours is a very happy Christmas. So let me ask you, what would make this Christmas happy for you? And what would you really like for Christmas?
And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered those things which were told them by the shepherds.
This Christmas, while you're enjoying your mashed potatoes at Grandma's annual Christmas feast, there are some people who won't be getting very much or giving very much because they simply don't have very much. Someone just this week lost a job and there's no money for extras. Someone this week found out that insurance won't cover that claim. Now they're in a jam. Someone yesterday, perhaps, found out that the investments they'd made to fund their retirement have collapsed. Now they're not going to have nearly as much as they thought they would. So at Christmas, what really matters? Is it the stuff? Is it the gifts and the Christmas tree and the lights on the outside of the house? What really matters this Christmas? Now let's think about this from God's point of view. When we think about what we want for Christmas, that's one thing. But what would God want? If God had a Christmas wish list, what do you think would be on it? If God said, "All I want for Christmas is," how do you think He would finish that sentence? World peace? Sure, God would want that, wouldn't He? Full churches? In many cases, no doubt. No more war or violence in the streets? Surely God would want to see an end to oppression and racism and hate and violence of all kinds. But as important as those things are, they're secondary. That is, peace in the world can only come when there's truly peace in the heart. In the Proverbs, God tells us what He wants for Christmas. In Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 26, God says, "My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways." God asks for your heart this Christmas. It's a simple request, but it's not always easy for people like you and me to fulfill. Now, what do I mean by that, by saying it isn't always easy for a person to give his or her heart to God? As sinful human beings, we wrestle with our own will, our own desires and wants. And sometimes, giving God our heart seems like the toughest thing of all. Now, not to give God our heart would be for us to make the same mistake as it was made by the people of Israel when Jesus came the first time. John wrote that He came unto His own, and His own received Him not. Think of who the people were who were prepared to meet Jesus. A few humble shepherds, and some wise men from a foreign country. Then there was Anna, and there was Simeon, but in a country that was built upon the hope of the coming of the Messiah, that was precious few. When Jesus came to the earth the first time, that first Christmas, His parents couldn't even find a place for Jesus to dwell. I sincerely hope it won't be that way this Christmas. Christ is looking for a dwelling place this Christmas, not a stable, not an inn. He's looking for a heart. "My son, my daughter, give me your heart," God asks. Paul wrote to the Ephesians and discussed the hope in Ephesians 3 and verse 17. We read there, Ephesians 3 and verse 17, "that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith." And in Revelation 3 and verse 20, the same Jesus is looking for a place to rest. And He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." What's most important this Christmas? As important as some of the trappings and even the traditions of Christmas have become, surely the most important part of Christmas is Christ. Not simply the historical Christ, the baby in the manger, but the present-day Christ, looking for lodging, looking to see if you'll give Him the best gift you could give Him, the gift of your heart, the gift of your life.
And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, "Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed."
In Matthew 4:4, the Word of God says, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Every Word is a one-minute Bible-based daily devotional presented by Pastor John Bradshaw and designed especially for busy people like you. Look for Every Word on selected networks or watch it online every day on our website, itiswritten.com. Receive a daily spiritual boost. Watch Every Word. You'll be glad you did. Here's a sample.
Merry Christmas. I hope you're able to take some time today with family and friends, or if that isn't possible, do take time with God and remember how great His blessings have been. Christmas Day is evidence that God is faithful. The birth of Jesus proves that God keeps His promises. God promised in Micah 5 and verse 2 that Jesus would come. He said, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are of old, from everlasting." God kept his promise, and there's no reason he won't continue to keep his promises to you. If you're making this day special, I hope it's a perfect day. I'm glad I've been able to greet you. God bless you today. Merry Christmas. I'm John Bradshaw for It Is Written. Let's live today by every word. It Is Written is sharing the good news of the gospel around the world. Part of our mission is to bring the Word of God to some of the most remote places on earth. Right now, we're providing audio Bibles to the people of Papua New Guinea. We call this audio Bible the God Pod. Through this solar-powered MP3 player, people can hear God's Word in their own language. If you'd like to help It Is Written share the Word of God by providing solar-powered God Pod Bibles, please call our toll-free number, 1-800-253-3000. Call right now. Just tell the operator you would like to help with the God Pod Project. You can also participate by sending your gift to It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91359. And for your convenience, you can also make a gift online at itiswritten.com. This ministry uses every reasonable effort to fund its projects as described. Should the project become fully funded, or should the nature of the project change due to unexpected circumstances, funds will be directed towards similar worthy projects. Our toll-free number is 1-800-253-3000, and our web address is itiswritten.com.
She was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she, coming in that instant, gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem.
My dad told me many years ago about the gift that meant most to him. The Christmas in question was many years before, and a number of years before I was born. One of my older brothers had wanted to buy Dad a gift, so he scraped together what was then only a few cents and went and bought Dad a little bar of shaving soap. And that touched my father's heart. It was more special to him than any other gift he'd ever received. What do you think that was? Because it came from the heart. It was given with love, and a lot of it. The innocent, giving, self-sacrificing love of a little boy doing something sweet for his daddy. See, that's what's really important. A gift that's given from the heart. This year, I wonder what you'll give Jesus for Christmas. I'm sure I can safely say that he doesn't really want or need anything that you could buy at a department store or anything you could order online. But Jesus wants something given from the heart. In fact, he wants your heart. Just a small thing, but is what he wants from you and from me. Can you give Jesus your heart this Christmas?
And when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own city, Nazareth. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him.
We wish for you a Christmas filled with the love and presence of God. Whatever your circumstances this year, we hope you remember that God so loved the world that he gave. The birth of Jesus represents the givingness and the love of a great God, a God who inspired the Bible writer to write, "He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up freely for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?"
I want to invite you to pray with us. Christmas Day, we have a lot to be thankful for, and even if your Christmas Day is filled with, from your perspective, maybe even more challenges than blessings, we still have so much to be thankful for as we pray to the God who so loved this world that he gave the greatest gift that could ever be given. Let's all pray together. Our Father in heaven, today we thank you And we thank you for Jesus, who was willing to give himself for the lost people of this lost world. And we thank you that in your goodness and in your love, whatever our circumstances today, we can know that there is a God of love who truly loves us and has prepared for us a bright and a hopeful future. How many more Christmas days there can be until Jesus comes back to this world to take us home, we do not know. But until he returns, I pray that you would help us to be faithful, to trust you, to believe in you, and to lean on you. You who have given us so much, we say to you, thank you. And we pray that you will continue to bless us, not merely for our own sake, but so that you would be glorified. You have truly given us the greatest blessings. And for that today, we say thank you. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Perhaps our program today has impressed you with a personal need for deeper Bible study. If you desire to listen to God and follow where He leads, we've got a wonderful resource that can help you to do that in a systematic way. The Discover Bible Guides. These Bible guides are easy to use and can be yours absolutely free. If you live in North America, we'll send you these full-color guides, or you can find them on our website, itiswritten.com. Request the Discover Bible Guides by calling our toll-free number, 1-800-253-3000. Lines are open 24 hours. They may be busy, so keep trying. You may also request today's offer by writing to It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91359. Thank you for your letters and for your continued support. Our toll-free number is 1-800-253-3000, and our web address is itiswritten.com. From all of us here at It Is Written, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to you as well. I hope you'll join us next time. Until then, please remember, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God.